to see many of my teachers here in the audience, distinguished teachers, including Professor Sharada Menon, who used to be my teacher. I'm delighted that she is here in the audience today. She's very close to our family and is a major influence on my career. And my aunt and uncle, Dr. Mahadevan, Saroja, and I won't make a big list of names, but Dr. Avias has been a friend and colleague for a long time. I've collaborated with him on many occasions. And I'm sure there are many other people, friends here, who are not naming person. So I'm going to talk to you about the human brain and its functions, mainly about neurology. And I'm going to approach this extraordinary problem by studying patients who have sustained injury to a small region of the brain. And the question is, what happens to their mind, what happens to their behavior when a small region of the brain is damaged or is altered as a result of either injury or as a congenital change in the region of the brain. Now, can you hear me in the back? Is it audible?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to make sure. How many of you are medical people, so I don't have to go over basics? Anybody who is not medical? It saves me a lot of time. You guys are smart, so you can figure it out. It doesn't matter that you're not medical. So, okay, so there'll be some overlap with the lecture I gave the other day at Dr. V.S. Krishnamurthy's venue. So you may be listening to some of the same material. I hope that that's okay. Now the challenge that we're confronted with is quite extraordinary. Just think about it. Here is a 1.5 kilogram gel in the head, in the cranial wall. And it's made up of 100 billion nerve cells. Each nerve cell is a structural and functional unit of the nervous system, makes contacts with adjacent nerve cells, with synapses, and each synapse can be on or off, inhibitory, excitatory, and there are 1,000 to 10,000 synapses between adjacent neurons. So neurons make contact with adjacent neurons, points of contact with synapses, 1,000 to 10,000 points of contact. And somebody's worked out, based on this information, the number of permutations and combinations of brain activity exceeds the number of elementary particles in the known universe. And this gives you some idea of the staggering complexity that you're dealing with and understanding the brain. Here's this massive jelly in your skull whose complexity, whose number of possible brain states exceeds the number of elementary particles in the universe. You're trying to crack the code used by the brain in representing events and objects in the external world. What is the language of the brain? The nervous system. How does the brain work? How does this lump of jelly give rise to a whole spectrum of human nature and human consciousness? If you think about it, all your hopes, your ambitions, your triumphs, your passions, your career, your social life, your being conscious of a teacup in front of you or a person in front of you, even what you call your own personal self has its origins in the activity of nerve cells in the brain. So how does it come about? Even the person asking the question is right here. How does this miraculous transmission occur? This is what we're trying to answer. Many approaches to this, one is to do brain imaging. You ask a person to perform a certain task, wave a hand or touch his nose or cough or anything, and then you find what part of the brain lights up and does that. That gives you some idea that that part of the brain is involved in the function. But that's not enough because the brain is doing all sorts of things even on idle. You then do what's called a subtraction. If you ask a person to do this, ask him to do nothing but the resting state, subtract it from the, when he's moving his finger, and you get brain rhythm responsible for that action, involved in that action. This is all common knowledge. I'm going to dive into the research now. The approach we use mainly is to look at patients who have sustained an injury, in a small injury in a small part of the brain, but producing drastic changes of behavior, profound changes in the mind. And what you see is, astonishingly, when there's damage to the brain, if you choose the right patient, not an across-the-board reduction in all your mental capacity, not a blunting of your mind, generalized blunting of your mind. What you see is a highly selective loss of one function, other functions being preserved intact. That gives you some confidence in asserting that that region of the brain is specialized for that function, is involved in that function. And that's what the whole lecture is about. Let me give you many examples of this. Let me give you one striking example which may not be known to most of you. I've talked about phantom limbs a lot. So most of you are aware from press reports of my having listened to my TED talks, what phantom limb is about. But now I'm going to tell you something extraordinary. Patient loses his arm in a battle or in a car accident, or electrical amputation for the cancer, continues to vividly feel the presence of that arm missing. We call that a phantom. This has been known since antiquity. He knows that it's not there, he's not delusional. He doesn't think I'm there. He says, doctor, the arm is gone. I know, but I feel it's there. It's an illusion, not a delusion. Now the converse of the syndrome is much more rare, and most people have not heard of it, not even my colleagues in neurology or psychiatry. That is, a person with a completely normal arm wants the arm removed. He says, doctor, this arm is intruding on me. So this guy, at the age of 70, I saw a patient who's an engineer, dean of engineering, at the school, a very well-known university of the United States, comes to me and says, after he retired at the age of 70, he says, doctor, I want my arm removed. And I know it's not possible to do that in this country. It's illegal in Canada, in the United States. I thought you might know somebody in Mexico or Canada who amputated a normal, apparently normal arm. Illegal to do that in the United States. I was shocked and really surprised to hear this. And then I noticed that other people have this disorder. When you go to the internet, you see this, it's been described. It's called apotopnophilia, an unpronounceable name. Also called xenomelia. X-E-N-O-M-E-L-I-A, xeno means foreign. And about half these patients, third to half these patients, go and get it amputated. So it's not some mild psychological problem and give them medication and get better. About half of them go and actually get it on them. It's an extraordinary problem, very serious problem, nothing more important than life and limb, as they say. So what's going on in the brain? Standard theory, and recently was a Freudian theory, believe it or not. Theory was that this guy, when he was a... But you ask the question, how long have you had this? As far back in childhood as I can remember, I had this urge to have my arm removed. Then you say, the Freudian answer is that this person is engaging in wishful thinking, attracting attention to himself. It's a cry for help. The person is emotionally starved for attention. So he says, remove my arm. And this is stupid theory. Think about it. Why not remove your ear or something more? Why move an arm? Why is it something drastic like that? I never believed that. Another theory is a sort of phallic theory. That is, this person wants an arm amputated, he has a stump that becomes a substitute penis. I'm not making this up. I'm going to look at the primary interest of these theories that we support. Now, I said this is not right. It's kind of the right reason. There must be another reason in the brain. When you go and look at the brain, frontal lobe, parietal lobe, occipital lobe, temporal lobe, in the premotor cortex here, post-central gyrus, there's the rolandic sulcus, the central fissure, behind it, the vertical strip. There's a complete map of the body surface and the surface of the brain. You show on the next slide. Okay, there it is. That's the post-central gyrus. The complete map of the body, and behind it is another area called S2, somatosensory cortex. There's another complete map. There are several maps of the body surface of the brain, including in S2, joints, tendons, muscles, positions of the fingers. But this map is constructed here, and then it's sent to a superior parietal lobule, the parietal lobule, right in the brain, which is the great convergence zone with different sensory inputs, the right superior parietal lobule, where it combines vision, hearing, proprioception, joint muscle sense, construct your body image, a vivid image of your body moving through space and time. So when I close my eyes, you will imagine, when I open my eyes, it's confirmed that vision. This whole process requires a conversion to signals into superior parietal lobule. But before that, the somatosensory cortex, the map of the body surface, that can be seen in the next slide. Okay, that's the famous Penfield diagram, coronal section to the brain, through the post-central gyrus, and you can see all the body parts represented, mapped out by Penfield in epileptic patients undergoing surgery. And you touch different parts of the brain, stimulate different parts of the brain, you get forehead, lips, cheek, hand, torso, leg. Notice that the face is much bigger than the entire torso, reflecting the great use you put your face to. Even your hand is much bigger than the torso, right? So these are interesting features about the map. missing the arm. So sometimes they just go from the hand there. There's no place there for them to protect you, so the brain gets confused. So I don't want his arm. Now this seemed a very naive speculation. We tested it using brain imaging, functional magnetic resonance imaging, MEG. And we mapped out the surface of the brain in a normal human volunteer. That's the map you see, mine. We did it on a patient with acute hemophilia. It was completely normal, the map. So I gave you a negative result. So we said, well, it's a waste of time. The theory is wrong. Then we did what's called a galvanic skin response. You go and poke the person's body with a small needle or a toothpick. When you poke the person, the message goes to the thalamus, and then eventually it gets to the insular cortex, amygdala, anterior cingulate, experience pain or touch. It just goes to the fundamental. I'm not going too fast, I'll slow down. So I'm talking about the touch and pain pathways from the skin to the post-sensitis and the pain centers in the brain, anterior cingulate, amygdala. So I said, maybe this cascade is interrupted. The patient has some loss of sensitivity or something is wrong. So I poked him with a needle, measured the galvanic skin response to map out his response, and he found that again, in the affected arm, galvanic skin response is heightened. Far from being less than normal people, it's actually heightened. You give him a felt, and this is what clued us into the fact that this is not a psychiatric disturbance, that the patient is a neurologic problem. You know, the golden rule in neurology and in any medical discipline is talk to the patient before you do any test or imaging or it's a dying heart or serious nerve. The first pen has no point and we know the diagnosis most of the time. We give the guy a felt pen and tell him where do you want the amputation. And he draws a line that is oblique. A very peculiar line, different for each patient. And you test him after a month without telling him, again you draw the same line, the photograph. This test, retest consistency tells you he's not confabulating, he's not making it up. How would he remember where he drew the line? Secondly, the precision of the line shows it's not psychological propensity, but that it's probably a neurological issue. Right? Because if it's a vague tendency to get the arm removed, why would it matter what the line is? See, you can get that one. I don't want it to be too much, too short or too long. This clues you into the neurological problem when you started studying. Then we found, if you go to the higher center, so this is where the somatosensory map is, what I was telling you about touch sensations in joints and muscles. So all that is not in the diet. So the theory was flawed, disproved. Then you went to this inferior parietal lobe, where you construct a representation, more abstract, dynamic 3D representation, using vision, hearing, touch, perception, everything. That region, that map was missing the hand. Touch the hand, there's no response. We've finally shown that there's a neurological basis to this strange disorder, which explains what's going on. Now, but what happens is, therefore, the signals from the hand, the skin of the hand, must have been, they are processed normally, go through the thalamus, go to the post and that is everything normal. But when the signal is relayed to the anterior parietal lobe, there's no place for it to go. The brain abhors discrepancy, it hates discrepancy. This gets sent to the amygdala, and the brain reacts and says, I don't want the arm. It's intrusive. You remove the arm, the patient's depression lives a normal life, becomes totally normal. Many patients are much happier with the arm. Okay, that's an example of a bizarre, seemingly incomprehensible neurological disorder where you can do some simple experiments lasting 2 hours with the electrodes in the skin, measuring the sweating, do some brain imaging and show that the Freudian theory is not correct in this case because the physiological explanation. Can you help the patient? I don't know yet. I'll get to that later. The more common syndrome, which we've studied extensively, I'll go through it very briefly because you already know about it, is phantom limb. Arm is amputated after for gangrene or for tumor. Patient vividly feels the presence of the arm. And 98-97% of patients develop a phantom after the arm is amputated. It's not a trivial problem. Many of them, about two-thirds of them, develop excruciating pain in the phantom, lasting for decades. Pain is intractable, excruciating. Some of them commit suicide, lose their jobs. Serious clinical problem. So how do you treat it? First of all, you want to know what's going on in the brain. What's going on in the brain of the patient? So I have a patient with a phantom limb, left arm is amputated, vivid phantom on the left side, sitting in my office, and I did a routine neurological exam, sensations, touching different parts of the body, asking what do you feel. He's sitting here. By the way, I can skip the entire phantom limb section, which is about 10 minutes long, if it's all of you already know about. It's up to you. AABS, can I go over it anyway? What do you think? Raise your hand if you want me to go over it anyway. Alright. Okay, so now let's go to phantom limbs. So I took this patient, his arm, his left arm was amputated above the elbow. He's a phantom and he's seated in the chair. I took a Q-tip, touched parts of his body and asked him, what do you feel? What do you feel? That's my shoulder though. That's my belly and it tickles. That's my chest. That's my left side of my chest. That's my left shoulder. Oh my God! You're touching my left phantom limb. That's my phantom thumb. That's my phantom index finger. That's my phantom pinky. There's a complete map of the missing phantom hand on his face. That's shown in the... I'm sorry. Oh, I'm missing a slide, but you have to believe me. You go and touch the patient's face, there's a complete mass of the missing hand in the face. But depending on which part of the face you touch, the different finger gets activated in the patient's face. Now, why would this happen? It doesn't make any sense. The mystery fit for Sherlock Holmes. Why would a phantom limb patient with a missing left arm, and you touch his face, feel the sensation of the missing hand? Then we realize, look at the peripheral diagram, I'll go over it very quickly because of old stuff. Peripheral diagram. Notice that the face is right next to the hand. So when the arm is amputated, there's no sensory input coming to the hand area of the cortex because the hand has been removed. Is that clear? Hand has been removed. So this area of the brain, hand area, has no sensory input. It's hungry for sensory input. Maybe secretes some trophic, but we don't know what. So the face skin normally goes to the face area. Invades the vacated territory corresponding to the missing hand. When you touch the face, the message goes not only to the face area of the cortex, cross activates the hand area, but because it's cross wiring. And higher centers in the brain interpret this signal as arising from the missing phantom hand. That's why we get a map of the face, map of the hand on the face. Is that clear so far? Now, the interesting thing, you can do further experiments. You can map out dozens of patients, you find that the map is always here. Rarely. Now, there's something wrong with my theory, and you see that immediately. If my theory is right, I say the face is right next to the hand, therefore when you touch the hand, the patient, touch the face, the patient feels it in the hand. Look at the diagram, tell me what's wrong with my idea. Quick. And I'm talking about cross-wiring, so the input from the hand skin normally goes to the hand, cross activates the face, essentially. That's why you feel the sensation arising from the hand in the touching face. What's wrong with it? Remember what I told you, the map of the hand is always in the lower part of the brain. Look at the face there. Lower part of the hand, further away. It's this region that's near the hand, the chin and the lower part. The forehead is actually here. So when you amputate the arm, wrong diagram. This is a modified diagram. I'm sorry. Somebody picked it up. Who picked it up? Okay. The other slide over there. Where is the other slide? Okay. Alright. I tripped you. I'm sorry about that. Oh, my student mentioned that. Okay. The original Penfield diagram, that face is the other way around.
Yes.
How many of you remember that? People remember that? Raise your hand. All the neurologists, psychologists, every textbook has his head the other way around. What we found was the map of the face is always on the lower side, even though the head is the other way around. So we said, cut a long story short, he said either Penfield is wrong or we are wrong. Maybe Penfield got the head wrong way around. Students in my lecture in Stanford visited this, went and did an fMR on several normal people and found Penfield was wrong. The head is, this is the correct map. It's intriguing that we can spend 1 hour with the patient phantom limb and correct the anatomy as part of the textbook. The day I go through the anatomy again and change all the text. That's what's happening. Okay, next I'm going to tell you about phantom limbs. The phantom limb is often painful. It's true. fixed in a particular position. The bed is there. It feels like it's in a block of cement. I can't move it. It's in a block of ice. When I try to move it, I start sweating and it's very painful. Or they get cramps. The phantom goes into clenching spasm. Nails digging into the phantom. What nail? What part? There's nothing in the phantom. And I said, what role does vision play in maintenance of the phantom? Exclusively semantics is not. Does vision play a role? Right. So what we did, this occurred to me when I saw a patient a long time ago, maybe 20 years ago. Patient with a phantom that was sitting in front of me. And listen carefully, this is very instructive. Patient with a phantom right on, sitting in front of me. Phantom was mobile. In about half the patient, the phantom would move, pat his brother on the shoulder, shake hands with you, reach out, grab the phone and ring. Very vivid movements. But because front part of the brain, premotor cortex, is sending signals to the phantom, it doesn't know it's a phantom, it's a signal. This is being monitored by a practical experience that phantom. Okay? Now I had a cup in front of me, and I said, please grab the cup with the phantom. Can you do that? And he said, okay. Now I'm grabbing the cup. And it's, you know, very, very vivid. Feel the arm moving better. Is that clear? I said, move your hand back. I'm going to move the cup further away. But maybe slightly. Then I said, can you not move your hand? Without telling him, when you move his hand to reach the cup, I pulled it away, like 4 feet away. Why would the physical limits of flesh apply to the hand? Why not stretch the hand to 4 feet? 400 feet. It's in the mind, after all. So I pulled the cup away and he said, ah! What? I had already got over the cup, doctor, and pulled the cup away. I said, you don't have a hand. What are you talking about? I was holding and I felt the pain. So that gave me the inkling that vision played a tremendous role. And I was sitting incubating in my brain when I devised a new trick of the phantom limb. So to cut a long story short, I have these patients with immobilized phantom limbs, excruciatingly painful, awkward position. And I was saying, can you move your phantom? Maybe that will animate the phantom, liberate it, and make it feel good and get the pain. He said, I can't move it. And I tried to move it, I get pain. I said, okay, let me look at the medical charts. These people often had a pre-existing nerve lesion in the hand, brachialepiphyseal avulsion, arm was lying lifeless in a sling, pain. Misguided attempt to get rid of the pain, they amputated the painful intact hand, amputated. You get a phantom arm in a phantom sling, with phantom pain persisting in the leg. This is the essential problem. So I said, maybe when the arm was intact, every time the guy was trying to move the hand, he's getting a signal saying, nah, it's painful, don't move it. Ouch, it's painful, don't move it. Ouch. The motor command to the arm to move was itself associated with pain. Learned the pain. The very act of volition, moving hand, is linked to a pain signal. And patient experiences pain 8 times. When you amputate the arm, the phantom is equally painful. How do you cure it? I said, let's now give him a visual feedback to close the loop. He sends a command. Now make him think the phantom limb is obeying his command. Let me close it, moving away. Precisely. How do you do that? If you didn't have an arm, how do you make him see the arm coming towards you? X-file. Sort of magic, what do you do? This is virtual reality. Look up motor signals to a computer, a visual, virtual vision feedback, giving the signal that the arm is moving. Now, at that time it cost $1.5 million. It was very crummy, it didn't work. It works in real time, very, not in real time, very crummy. So I said, forget that, let's use a $1 mirror. So we picked up $1 mirror and a diamond nickel store, put it on the table, inside a cardboard box, patient's left hand with the phantom, right hand and right hand, and then he looks at the reflection, and you've resurrected visually his phantom optically. Phantom did not come back, he knows that, but he chuckles, the patient chuckles. 10 years ago he had an amputation, 10 years of excruciating pain in the phantom limb, clenched in one position, he can't move it, put the mirror up with the right hand, and told him, perform mirror symmetrical movements, like conducting an orchestra, saying goodbye, or clapping, any mirror symmetrical movement while looking inside the mirror. He's going to get the visual signal saying that the phantom is now moving, obeying his command precisely. Is that clear? And what happened? He said, I can't move my phantom, I can move my right hand, I can't move my phantom. But look in the mirror, try to do it in it. Pretend it's GSP. He did this, he said, my God, I don't believe it. For the first time in 8 years, 9 years, my phantom is moving again. It's wonderful. I can move my hand, like my fist. And it feels so good. My pain's going. And if you close your eyes, oh my God, it's fixed. It's painful. plane, the temporary interrupting signals, the demon goes back to the start of the plane. Maybe that component can be revived using a mirror. It sounds silly to think about it. Using a mirror to retrieve stroke. Let's go time and verse. I said, look, first of all, see if it works. He uses a mirror for a week, throw out the mirror, and he can move his hand. Forget about the mirror. But he took it home, spent a week doing this, and phoned me up, and I said, what's going on? I've been practicing vigorously in the box. Anytime I move my right hand, left hand, looks like it's moving, and feels good, pain goes there. We remove the box, it comes back. It eventually pain still there. It doesn't work. I said, right for another week. Right for another week, he phones me, agitated. He said, Dr. Raman, please. It's gone. I said, what's gone? Phantom limb is gone. I said, I was alarmed. There's a human subject in ethics. It's a big deal. You permanently altered a human being's body. I said, does this bother you? He said, no. Because, you know, I used to have a phantom pain in the elbow and wrist and upper arm. No, I didn't have a phantom last 3 days. I didn't have this pain. But the problem is, my fingers, phantom fingers, are still stuck to the shoulder telescope. Your box does not reach the finger. Can you change the design to eliminate my finger? This guy, I tell my colleague in medicine, the first example in the history of medicine, the successful amputation of a phantom limb. This is now being used in things throughout the world, and what you do is you put the mirror, the study I showed you by Tsao and company, New England Journal of Medicine about 10 years ago, about 24 patients, 8 patients on mirrors, from severe pain, 4 weeks of 10 minutes each of mirror therapy, down to barely noticeable, just noticeable pain. Covered mirror, placebo, no change. Visualization, pain, visualize the pain going away, visualize the arm moving, noticing pain goes up, cross over, the pain comes down and down to this level. Last for 6 months, lost pain. This is about as good as it gets in pain medicine, as pain neurology. I mean, consider the fact that quite like Prozac, right in the market, so this is an astonishingly big effect. This has been replicated and used widely throughout the world. Now next we said, what else can you learn about phantom limbs? We thought we'd finished all the experiments in phantom limbs. Then we found that the patient with the phantom limb was sitting there, and I predicted this. I said, if I touch my finger, what will happen? I don't know why I asked, but I learned about mirror neurons. From Giacomo Buccellato, everybody knows about mirror neurons. Mirror neurons have certain neurons in my brain. The motor command neuron, when I go and reach and grab a beam, one neuron fires, grab a slide predictor, microphone, one neuron fires, turn a page, another neuron fires, put a peanut in my mouth, another neuron fires. They're motor command neurons. They orchestrate a series of muscle twitches that lead to performance of a simple motor act, semicircular motor act. Going from premotor to motor cortex, down the thalamus, to spinal cord, up to the nerves. That's known for a long time. 10% of the so-called motor neuron will fire if I watch my motor neuron on the left hemisphere is firing, premotor cortex, motor cortex, B5. When I reach out and grab, and brrrr, neuron is firing. The complete map of the motor, the body parts in that map. I watch Dr. Avias reaching out on this, the same bloody neuron fires. I'm not even being touched, and I'm not moving it. I'm watching Avias move. It's ESP, like ESP, the mind reading neuron. I'm figuring out, my brain is taking the visual input, computing what AVS is up to, what is impending action. It's creating a virtual reality simulation of Dr. AVS's mind. It's not a mind reading neuron, mirror neuron, monkey see monkey neuron. Posteriorly, S2, you find most of the neurons are sensory neurons. You touch the elbow, mass. 10% of the sensory neurons is fired. If you touch him on the shoulder, please. This touches the shoulder. That neuron is fired. And he's watching him, not being touched. The neuron is taking the vision input. Say, what is it like to be touched? Empathy. There are empathy neurons in insular, anterior cingulate. If you poke with a needle, I don't know what you're doing. Poke with a needle, anterior every single day on fire. Pow! The drum man. And that student on fire. Yeah, he touched. Pow! The drum man. So I poke him in the middle and watch him. Same neurons fire. That's it. Question is, so I'm empathizing with him. I know what it's like to be ABS. It's true. But I don't shout out to draw my hand. That would be stupid to go around and some empathy is good. But if I start moving like you, moving my arm away, he poked me with a needle. My behavior would be maladaptive. But how does a neuron know the difference? Neuron sitting there, firing away, you poke me with a needle and fire, you poke me with a needle and fire. So this is for empathy. But how does a neuron know I shouldn't put on my hand and run away? These sympathetic areas feel his pain, but don't literally feel it. How do you know? The answer is that the visual signal coming from my skin. My skin receptors, pain receptors, are going and telling the mirror neurons, you can fire all you want, but don't run away or withdraw your hand because you're not being moving.
Maybe this learned pain. When you have a trivial injury, most of you don't move your hand.
pretty speculative. So put a mirror, same solution to this mirror. Put the hand on the right side, same commands to both hands. You look like a dystrophic hand in normal, look normal, because the reflection is normal hand. Look like a moving hand. Will that help alleviate the pain? Sure, real pain in a real hand. He proposes in a meeting, four authors in Oxford, writer, and a mirror box, nine patients with RSV. In three of the patients, the hand started moving immediately. Immediately, on the table. They did not move for 6 months. Temperature fell down. You cannot take temperature in the hand. There's no placebo effect. And they remove the hand, swelling, redness changed. In three of the patients, nothing happened. People lasted years after the injury. In three patients, there's some recovery. Three patients, there's substantial recovery. Now it's the accepted treatment, first line of treatment choice, according to New England Journal of Medicine, for RSV. Then you go on to synthetic ganglion medication. These people have done all kinds of treatment. They go through medication, even heart problem medicine. Ganglion anatomy is sometimes useful, effective. But majority of cases is intractable. You do a $2 mirror, non-invasive, you take it home, think it's good. So now it's widely used throughout the world. That's one of the things. Now I want to say very emphasize that mind-body activity. Here is your mind changing the skin color, temperature, vascularity, swelling, pain, all of it's coming top down to the brain. I don't have a better example of mind-body interaction. If you talk about mind-body, people in the West regard it as mumbo jumbo. This new age medicine. You see in your front of your eye, that's what happens. You can use the phantom pain, CRDS, stroke. It's been used for stroke. People have now started using mirrors for early hemiparesis, even late hemiparesis. Some patients have dramatic recovery of function in the parotid arm, using a mirror for half an hour a day. The group at Vellore has done double time clinical trials. You can go into Google and look at it. It's not as dramatic as phantom pain and RSV, but you do see the effect. Okay. Okay. Again, mirror neuron. I can't help telling you, clinical audience, I can't help telling you about another observation. Very preliminary, not studied systematically in a clinical trial. I want to emphasize one thing. You know, when you report a case study, the patient with an extraordinary disorder, Capgras syndrome, phantom pain, epidermal media, often we begin with one case and try to publish it. The colleagues say, that's just one case. Show me another one. I don't believe it. But guess what? The entire golden age of neurology, all the famous discoveries, the Schuller's test, took this test in time. A patient in the case, Broca, the face patient, two cases. Cavazzoni, one or two cases. Neglect, two cases. Levinsky. One of the faces, one case. Broca's face, one case. Broca. You tell me one major syndrome discovered by statistical analysis of the golden age. Zero. One case is enough. You do the right experiment. So I give you an analogy, but bring a pig to the audience. Bring a pig here. And tell you guys, a pig can fly. That's stupid. What do you mean pig can fly? Way my mom, pig starts falling. That would be said. I said, my God. You know, but I'm going to show me another pig. So this is important. Single case study. You know, I want to emphasize that, especially younger neurologists here who we've started a career. Start with one case, do the right experiment, and make discoveries, not by doing statistics. You have to be careful though, because our modus operandi, you know, look at strange disorder. I'm going to tell you a few more before you close. And you have a nose for anomaly. It's been described in the past by Russian as a carpet. Man said he wants an arm, you know, what can you do about it? Either you remove the arm and send him home. It's hypothetical. It doesn't work. Russian is a carpet, ignore. There are hundreds of diseases. What we do is pursue these disorders, precisely the ones that people have ignored. Study them in detail and find out what's going on. Brain, understand normal brain function by studying in patients and try to help the patient. This is the goal. We're not always successful. You only hear the success stories. Synesthesia. For every one successful detective work, there's five or six fizzled out. You don't hear about it, you don't publish it. Let me give you an example. A bogus disorder. Very careful. You spend a lifetime studying it. Duclarenbol syndrome. How many of you know what Duclarenbol syndrome is? Established quote-unquote disorder from the DSM, diagnosis, etc. lady, beautiful lady, who develops a profound fixed delusion that an old, rich, famous man is madly in love with her, but she's denying it. Psychiatry, you know. If I don't say any of you, you're laughing. I hope you don't take this seriously. Many of my colleagues believe in true syndrome. That is complete rubbish. And there's no name for the equivalent syndrome other way around, that an old, aging, famous male thinks that his young, attractive, hot lady is in love with him, and denies it. That's much more common than it is among my colleagues, because nobody has written a paper about it. So there's no name for the name of itself. That's one of them. Another example is chronic underachievement. This, in my days, is called stupidity. Child lacks motivation, not paying attention to class, now they have a name for it, chronic underachievement. Best one I can think of is oppositional defiance. So, you know about, how many of you heard of oppositional defiance? ODD. Nobody, no, no, psychiatry. Okay, opposite. The man who invented this disease is a genius. Because this disease refers to a spirited youngster who dares to question an establishment figure, like a professor or a psychiatrist or a parental authority. The diagnosis is oppositional defiance. So, the man who invented this disease is a genius, and any attempt to protest the diagnosis by the patient, it's just further evidence of the diagnosis. So you can never protest the diagnosis. Built into the disease. So you have to be careful when you study, that's the only thing I'm mentioning. But now, let's talk about OCD. It's a legitimate disorder. Serious problem. Patients who are hand washing, ritual hand washing compulsion. Scratching their skin, trying to wash their hands to the point that it starts bleeding. And the compulsion is very traumatic to the patient, emotionally traumatic. They can't avoid it. They're ready to compulsion, the famous example of see it all the time. There's no effective treatment. People do exposure therapy, which is the opposite. Don't do hand washing. Patients hate it. We said, maybe ritual hand washing involves neurons, which you can trigger with mirror. Maybe some of them are mirror. So you didn't have to wash your hands. Wash, maybe just wash your hands. You don't have to do this every time. Pretty information is came in. Watch ABS. You can't have ABS for it either. It's not going to let you pay. You get a videotape, an app, cell phone app, of yourself washing it, having it ready with you. Anytime you feel the urge, put the app on watch. The mirror neural system is being activated in OCD. It should abort the effect without the penalty of actually going to do it. Sure enough, in about half a dozen patients out of 12, mild to moderate OCD is substantial relief from using the app. You may have something like a cure, or at least how partially effective treatment for OCD is considered effective. Okay, now I'm going to switch gears to talk about various aspects of neurology. Shall I spend another 15 minutes talking about synesthesia? Okay, I'll talk about it. I'll go over very briefly and interrupt me. First cousin of Charles Darwin in the 19th century, a man named Francis Galton, noticed that the general population, certain percentage of the general population, very small percentage, 0.1% or less, have a quirk in their brain. Every time they see a number, they see a color. 5 is red, 6 is blue, 7 is yellow, 8 is green, 9 is chartreuse, 10 is yellow, 10 is 10 million people, red and yellow. Is that clear? Numbers of colors. People thought they were crazy, but only 5 is Indian. When you think somebody's saying something crazy, first thing you learn as a physician or in reality, he's not crazy, you're not smart enough to figure it out. Sometimes it's crazy, but usually, probe deeper, you find out the cause. You said, why would they consistently say that they're crazy? One theory is they're crazy, but figure it out. Another theory is they remember memories from childhood, playing with refrigerated magnets, 505, 6 is yellow, 7 is. Come along, I don't know, it's not done so much in this country. But in the West, they play with magnets in different colors. For some reason, they're stuck with this memory. This is stupid, because synesthesia runs in families. Galton pointed out, it's genetic basis. So why would the same magnets have been passed on from generation to generation? Maybe, but it seems unlikely. Some propensity to see the numbers of colors is being passed on. Genetic basis. So the third theory is that they are being metaphorical. 5 is red now, it's like saying Juliet is the sun. Or this tone is very sad. There's intersensory, inter-emotional interactions, which in these people are amplified. So they say finally, yes. Again, didn't make any sense, but it's on the right track, and I'll show you. Fourthly, they are on drugs. This is very common in California, so that's why the state is popular. Many students are on drugs. Turns out that the number area in the brain, the visual numbers area,